Hello everyone, a very happy new year to all. Welcome to Microsoft Partner Enablement Program. Our vision for this technical session is to empower every Microsoft partners to achieve more and improve their customer support experience. My name is Ashraf and I'm support escalation engineer here at Microsoft. I'm partnering with my peer Mohit for this session. Today we are going to discuss about Exchange Online Migrations. This session encompasses overview of Exchange Online Migration scenarios and troubleshooting issues. Now, let's get to the agenda of this session. We'll be starting with the types of migrations and followed by the hybrid deployments. Along with hybrid deployments, we will cover the features of hybrid migrations and how the mailbox getting migrated to Office 365. Also, we will walk you through the differences between DAuth and OAuth tools, which will help you for troubleshooting while performing the migrations, followed by few troubleshooting tips along with the data collections. Final one is Q&A session. Now we are going to see how many types of migrations are available in Office 365. As mentioned in the left side, there are 6 different types of migrations available to migrate data to Office 365. First one is cutover migration. Cutover migration is designed for small business organization. Only 2000 mailboxes can be migrated. The second one is stage migration. Stage migration support if the mailboxes are hosted in Exchange 2003 or 2007 only. Admin needs to provision the mailbox using directory synchronization tool. Next one is hybrid migration. To deploy hybrid migration, customer needs to have minimum Exchange 2010 with Service Pack 3 or later. It has rich coexistence features where cross-premises FreeBSD is supported and there is no downtime needed for mailbox migration. It also supports offboarding. This means if the admin decide to move the mailbox back to on-prem, that is also possible. We will see detailed information about hybrid migration from the upcoming slides. The fourth one is IMAP migration. Ideally, customer will choose to proceed with IMAP migration only when source mailboxes are present in non-exchange servers, like third-party servers. When customers choose IMAP as a migration solution, only the email items are migrated. Contacts and calendar items cannot be migrated by using IMAP migration. So to overcome this, we have introduced G Suite migration. In G Suite migration feature has been introduced to migrate mailboxes from G Suite to Office 365, allowing a migration project to be done in stages. This has an ability to migrate email, calendar and contacts with high reliability. The last one is Office 365 import service. If customer organization have many large PSD files and if they want to upload them to Office 365, they can use this Office 365 import service to migrate the data. On the right side, we also mentioned the comparison chart of which mailbox migration types can be used based on the source email servers. I will pause here for 20 seconds for you to go through that. All right, let me move on. In this slide, we are going to see the differences between cutover versus stage migration. Cutover is designed for a small or fast migration to Office 365, where stage migration is designed for mid-size organization. In cutover migration, mailbox and address book is migrated from on-premises Exchange server to Exchange Online via Outlook Anywhere protocol. Where in stage migration, only mailbox data will be migrated by using Outlook Anywhere protocol. And cutover migration is designed for all at once. However, in stage migration, you can migrate the data or mailboxes by using batches. Cutover is limited to 2000 mailboxes, which means if the organization has more than 2000 mailboxes, they will not be able to proceed with cutover migration. So they have to go with other type of migration, where in stage migration, there is no such limit exist. You will be able to choose cutover migration only when directory synchronization tool not deployed. Where in stage migration, it's one of the prerequisites that directory sync should be enabled and configured. This slide will help you on how to choose the best migration solution for our customers. The first criteria is, what is the size of the organization? You can compare between small, medium, and large. If it is a small organization, you can choose cutover. If it is a mid-sized organization, you can use staged migration. If it's a large organization, you can use hybrid deployment. And second scenario is based on the duration. If you choose cutover, it will be completed less than a week. Wherein stage migration will take 2 to 3 weeks and hybrid takes several months to complete it. The third criteria is based on features. There is no much features are available in cutover migration, but stage has galsync as well as batch migrations. Hybrid have many features like FreeWSI, secure mail flow, mail tips, in-place archive, etc. This is a high-level migration flow diagram for cutover migration. Consider the right-hand side is the, left side is the on-premises organization and right-hand side is the Office 365. As you see from the slide, Outlook Anywhere must be enabled and should be accessible over the internet in order to migrate the mailbox by using cutover. So it uses name service provider interface, which is nothing but NSPI protocol, to query the address book in order to migrate the mailboxes. So which means it will provision the users based on the user details available on the address book. Again, it has the limitation of 2000 mailboxes and it will perform the migration all at once. Similar to cutover migration, even for stage migration, uses Outlook Anywhere to migrate the mailboxes. However, customer must install directory synchronization tool in order to provision the users in Office 365. So once it has been done, mailbox can be migrated using batches. Moving on. G Suite migration. Introduced specifically to migrate the mailboxes from G Suite to Office 365. We have also attached the chart which shows what are the items can be migrated using G Suite type. I'll pause here for 10 seconds to quickly go through. So what is not migrated is rules, delegates, signature, and tasks cannot be migrated by using this migration type. Let me move on. Once the customer decided to migrate the mailbox using hybrid migration, and if they are ready to publish their server to internet, then they must ensure all prerequisites are in place in order to go for hybrid migration. The first and foremost prerequisite is, first we need to install the Active Directory synchronization tool and ensure that the users and groups are provisioned to Office 365. They also should install the third-party certificate and configure in order to assign the services. An auto-discover and other web services URL must be accessed from the external network. After ensuring all of them are installed and configured, then the customer can run the hybrid configuration wizard. Hybrid configuration wizard will help us to configure all the necessary configuration settings automatically. We will see in detail about how HCW works from upcoming slides. So hybrid deployment has two topologies. One is classic and the other one is modern topology. Exchange Classic Hybrid is the traditional hybrid approach where Exchange Online can connect to customers' Exchange server over the internet and vice versa. This requires Exchange server be accessible over the internet and trusted third-party certificate should be installed and configured. When to use this mode is ideally if you already publish your Exchange server endpoints such as OAuth and EWS URL to the internet, then we can use classic model. If not, then customer can choose Exchange Modern Hybrid. The major difference is this will install the hybrid agent that takes over the communication between Exchange Online and customers' on-premises Exchange server. The hybrid agent is based on Azure AD application proxy topology. The agent can be installed either on a standalone server or on an Exchange server. Customer consider this when they did not publish Exchange server to the internet for the incoming traffic. That's when they can choose to go for modern topology. So over the past several years, we have received the feedback from all sorts of customers on how the hybrid configuration wizard can be improved. One of the challenges we needed to overcome is that a stage migration is not supported for the mailbox deployed on Exchange Server 2010 or later. That left customer with two options, either perform a cutover migration or a hybrid migration. And we all know cutover migration is designed only for small customer deployments because all the user need to be migrated at the same time and all Outlook profile need to be recreated. This limitation of the cutover migration led many customers to deploy a hybrid configuration, but the hybrid configuration has strict prerequisites around with the certificate, external network, accessibility, etc. Due to which, many of the customers were unable to afford to run hybrid configuration wizard. To overcome this, hybrid migration has three different options now. One is full hybrid deployment. Second is minimal hybrid deployment. The third one is express hybrid deployment. Full hybrid migrations are best for large organizations that have thousands of mailboxes and complete integration between their on-premises Exchange servers and Office 365 for rich coexistence. Where minimal hybrid migration are best for mid-sized organizations and want to finish their migration within a month. However, features like FreeBSY and other enhanced features are not available in minimal hybrid. When customer run the hybrid configuration wizard with minimal hybrid, they also have an option to choose express migration. This migration are best for small organization that want to finish their migration within a week. So express migration does a one-time Active Directory sync with Office 365 to provision the recipients, and then it will help move the mailboxes to Office 365. Again, in this method also, there is no enhanced feature or available. Moving on. So we have mentioned here with a quick comparison chart of minimal versus full hybrid. I'll pause here for 20 seconds for you to go through it. All right, let me move on. So in this slide, we are going to see the detailed feature of hybrid. The first feature we can call it out as a FreeBSY, because the most of the customers will use this. So FreeBSY and calendar sharing between on-premises and Exchange Online organizations available, message tracking, mail tips, and multi-mailbox search between on-premises and Exchange Online organization is possible when they choose full hybrid deployment. The second foremost feature is integrated admin and user experience. Administrator will have the ability to manage all Exchange functions irrespective of mailboxes available in cloud or on-premises. Also, unified GAL, auto reply, mail tips, and over redirection is possible when we choose full hybrid mode. The other important feature is mailbox move. Hybrid provides online mailbox move, which means end user will not be impacted while his or her mailboxes getting migrated to Office 365. They will still have access to mailbox during migration. Also, no need to reconfigure the profile since mailbox signature also getting copied to Office 365. It also supports offboarding. The other feature is secure mail flow. So this mail routing with a shared domain namespace will help us to achieve the secure mail flow in hybrid deployment. It also has centralized control of inbound and outbound mail flow, which means customer can configure all inbound and outbound Exchange Online messages to route via on-premises Exchange server for auditing purpose. So these are the features for hybrid when we select full mode. Let me quickly walk you through if the customer has Exchange 2007, how they can opt in for hybrid migration. So consider this Exchange 2007 environment with internet facing site, and this is Office 365. So first, when we decided to go for hybrid deployment, as we know, one of the prerequisites is either we need to have Exchange 2010 with Service Pack 3 or higher. So first we need to ensure that existing server has all the service pack, all the latest service pack along with the rollups. And also we need to prepare the Active Directory schema for the upcoming version. So as we know, we can either go for 2013 or 2016 or 2019 in order to go for Exchange hybrid environment. So we need to install Exchange 2013 server, and we need to ensure that we are setting up the external URL for the web services virtual directory and also MRS proxy is enabled. So once it's done, we need to ensure that we are deploying the third-party certificate, and which has been configured for IIS as well as SMTP protocol. So once it has been assigned, we have to publish the URL as well as protocols to external, and we need to ensure that auto discover is pointing to Exchange 2013, because it is always recommended that we need to point the DNS record of our auto discover on the higher version of Exchange server in our environment. So once it's done, we are good to run with hybrid configuration wizard and move the mailboxes. So this is how the hybrid deployment will look like in the high level view. So we are going to see each and everything, what are the components involved in the hybrid. So let's consider if the customer already configured the hybrid configuration wizard and they would like to update the configurations. For example, they just wanted to update the existing certificate with the new certificate, or they just wanted to add the domain. So in that case, how hybrid engine will react? So consider if the hybrid configuration wizard has been already run for that environment, so it will be in the desired state. If the customer has rerun the hybrid configuration wizard by modifying some certificate or adding or removing some domains, those modification will be there on the current state. So hybrid configuration engine has an ability to compare the desired state versus current state, and whatever the changes between these two, it will perform the delta sync to Office 365 as well as on-prem. So what basically it does is hybrid configuration engine, it won't rerun or reconfigure all the settings which is available in Active Directory configuration partition. It will only perform the delta sync whichever modified recently by running the hybrid wizard. So far we have seen hybrid migration with single forest model. Technically we call it as 1:1 relationship, but from Exchange 2013 service pack 1 or later onwards, hybrid support multi-org, which means if customer owns two different organization and they want to migrate to one single Office 365 tenant, that is possible. So in technical term, we call it as 1:1 relationship. So we will see how this deployment looks like. So consider that customer is owning two different organization, the organization one called Contoso.com and the organization two called Fabricum.com. So if they decided to migrate both mailboxes from this organization to Office 365, what are the steps that they need to follow and how they can achieve this deployment? Let's see one by one. So once the customer is decided, first we need to ensure that there is a two-way trust has been enabled between Contoso.com and Fabricum.com. Once it has been enabled, we need to ensure that the mail communication between two different organizations are seamlessly working. Then we have to install the Azure AD Connect on contoso.com as well as fabricm.com should be pointing to Office 365. Then we are good to run hybrid configuration wizard on both the organization. So it means we need to run it on contoso.com as well as fabricm.com. So ADFS is an optional. Customer can decide whether they can install ADFS and password sync or not. So this is still optional. So once a hybrid configuration has been established, the org relationship will be in place so that the free busy secure mail flow and mailbox movement is possible for the multi-org environment as well. So this is how the customer can go for N:1 relationship. Let's talk about hybrid mailbox migrations. What are the components that involved during the migration process? So the cross-premises mailbox move process uses two services. Each client access server has an instance of the mailbox replication service and an instance of MRS proxy as part of the implementation of Exchange Web Services. So mailbox replication service uses RPC call, which is a remote procedure call, to move the mailboxes within an organization. Whereas MRS proxy uses HTTPS call to move mailboxes between organizations. So which means in this case, on-premises to Exchange Online. Unlike previous Exchange Server version, Exchange 2010 mailbox moves are processed through the client access servers only. Let's see what are the components are involved when we are performing the migration. So consider that we have submitted the migration move request by running new-move request command. Okay, so what will happen? So first, the migration job will be in queue state. So in this stage, what it does is it will engage the Active Directory of on-premises as well as Office 365 by engaging system mailbox to cross-check is there any duplicate jobs or exist or not. If it is not exist, then MRS of Exchange Online will communicate through MRS proxy in on-premises for us to establish the connection on source mailbox. That's when it will check for authentication and everything. So once the job is able to access the source mailbox, the first and foremost thing what it will do is it will scan the number of folders and number of items which is available on the source mailbox, and it will document. Once it has been scanned, it will start syncing the data from source mailbox to target mailbox, which is nothing but cloud. Once it has been synchronized, it will pass out 95%. So when we are performing the job itself, we can choose either autocomplete or we can complete it by manually clicking on complete job. So when we are completing the job at 95%, what it basically does is it will lock the mailbox to ensure no new emails are landing into on-premises mailbox. And it will also rescan the folder hierarchy along with number of folders and items. Then it will compare the stage 3 versus stage 4. Whatever the difference items are there, let's say for example, during the migration, customer may created the folders or customer may receive some emails. So those emails will be synced as a part of incremental sync. So once it has been done, what it will do, it will also convert the mailbox which is present in on-premises to mail enable user, and it will convert the mail enable user object which is available in cloud to mailbox. So these are the tasks has been performed while we are performing the move request. So let's see how clients getting redirection post the migration. So for example, the client might still pointing to on-premises Active Directory for us, right? So client doesn't know when the mailbox has been moved. So how it will react once the mailbox has been moved from source forest to target forest. So when we are relaunching the Outlook, it will try to contact the on-premises Active Directory forest to ask about where is my mailbox. Then on-premises Active Directory will reply back, hey, I do not have a mailbox here, but I do find a mail enable user with the target address. So with that redirect address, what Outlook client will do is it will redirect the packet to Exchange Online Server. In Exchange Online Server, it will find the mailbox and it'll ask for an authentication. So once authentication has been successful, then it will pass the information, which means Exchange Online Server will pass the information about mailbox details to the Outlook client to build the profile. So this is how communication will be re-established after the migration. So I'll be handing over this session to Mohit to proceed further. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashraf. Hello, everyone. I would be discussing about how FreeBSY works, how FreeBSY works when it is set up using OAuth, some of the tools that we use for troubleshooting, and few common issues. To get started, let's first talk about the difference between OAuth and DAuth. At a high level, OAuth uses the same trust broker concept as DAuth. Each exchange organization trusts the Azure Auth service, and tokens from that service are used to authorize requests, proving their authenticity. However, there are some differences between OAuth and DAuth. For example, DAuth uses Microsoft Federation Gateway for token generation. DAuth also utilizes organization relationship that controls what companies you share information with. It also allows you granular control as to what information has to be shared. Whereas in OAuth, it uses Auth server in Azure AD. The Auth server in Azure AD provide faster communication. OAuth make use of intra-org connector and configuration. In OAuth, we do not have granular control of feature set. Apart from the differences mentioned in this slide, OAuth also provides the ability to allow a server with the resource being requested to redirect the client or server requesting the data to the trusted issuer of access token. It does this when the calling server or client sends an anonymous call with an empty value in HTTP bearer header. A notable difference between the two is that OAuth tokens are not encrypted. The token is also passed as header information, not as part of body. There is therefore a reliance upon TLS to protect the traffic in transport. Moving on, let's talk about how FreeBSY works when you are in cross-forest hybrid environment. FreeBSY in hybrid environment works using either DAuth or OAuth. We will talk more about OAuth in later slides. In this example, we have considered an environment with no OAuth, where user Ben, who is an on-premise user, requests FreeBSY information of user Joe, who is migrated to Exchange Online. Ben client, Outlook or OWA, sends a request to on-premise CAS server for Joe's FreeBSY info. CAS server detects that Joe is a remote mailbox. CAS server then looks for available organization relationship for domain and validates where the request needs to be routed. It does this by validating the organization relationship and the federation relationship. CAS server then connects to MFG, that is Microsoft Federation Gateway, to request for a delegation token. Microsoft Federation Gateway provides the token to the CAS server, and then CAS server proceed by submitting this request token or delegate token to Exchange Online. Exchange Online validates this token and provides the FreeBSY information of Joe to user Ben. and user Ben would be able to see the FreeBSD info of user Joe. Moving on. In this slide, we have highlighted the two very important part of FreeBSD when FreeBSD is set up using DAuth. That is Federation Trust and Organization Relationship. When FreeBSD is set up using DAuth, a two-way Federation Trust is created between Microsoft Federation Gateway. And there is an organization relationship which defines how and where to route the request from users looking for FreeBSD info of another user located in different forest. When you create Federation Trust, you use domain namespace that is different from the domain used as your primary SMTP domain. Federation Trust also uses self-signed certificate that are automatically generated by the new Federation Trust wizard for the Federation Trust with the Microsoft Federation Gateway. To create Federation Trust, you also have to create a proof using, or you have to create that proof using a TXT record. Once Federation Trust is created, an organization relationship is created for sharing of information. Majority of misconfiguration occurs here. The DNS needs to be correctly configured externally, ensuring all parameters are correctly configured. We can make use of remote connectivity analyzer to check whether the organization relationship is set up correctly or not. Moving on, let's talk about OAuth in hybrid environment. When you click on Configure Hybrid Wizard, automatically creates intra-org connector and OAuth between Exchange On-Prem and Office 365. OAuth is used for enabling cross-premises discovery search or when you move archive. It also enables features like message records management and in-place archiving. Hybrid Configuration Wizard first adds a new OAuth server object to the on-premise AD Exchange organization, specifying the Azure OAuth service endpoint to use. The OAuth server object in OAuth is equivalent to the Federation Trust object and it stores things such as thumbprint of the Azure OAuth signing certificate, the token issuing endpoint, the OAuth metadata URL, and so on. Hybrid Configuration Wizard process creates a self-signed authorization certificate, the public key of which is passed to Azure OAuth service. And Azure OAuth service will use this to verify if token requests from the organization are authentic. The on-premise application ID and the relevant information are stored in OAuth config object. This is the OAuth equivalent of Federation Trust object we had in DAuth. The hybrid configuration wizard registers the all well-known application ID for Exchange on-premise. This is simply telling Azure OAuth service that Exchange Online may request a token for those URLs and that app ID which prevents token for any arbitrary URL being requested. Exchange Online URLs are managed automatically with Azure OAuth service, so there is no need for the admin to add the URLs for Exchange Online. Once this is done, Hybrid Configuration Wizard creates intra-organization connector object. This specifies the domains in other organization and the discovery endpoint. Moving on. So in this slide, for OAuth, the minimum criteria is to use Exchange 2013 SP1. However, even if you have lower version of Exchange installed, you can still use OAuth. You need to configure OAuth manually if you have lower version of Exchange. In a pre-Exchange 2013 organization, you have to install at least one Exchange 2013 SP1 or greater server with client access and mailbox server role in your existing Exchange organization. When you create OAuth manually, you first need to create authorization server object in Exchange Online. Post that, you enable the partner application. Once you are done with the above step, you need to export the on-premise authorization certificate and upload it to Azure Active Directory Access Control Service. You need to register all hostname authorities for your internal and external on-premise Exchange HTTP endpoint with Azure Active Directory, post which you can create the intra-organization connector from your organization, on-premise organization to Office 365 and vice versa. As a last step, you need to configure availability address space if you have any legacy environment. If you need more details about it, you can refer the TechNet article, which is mentioned in the slide. Moving on. Once you set up OAuth, to validate, you can use PowerShell command. To validate whether OAuth has been set up correctly or not, you run test-OAuth connectivity and you provide the service as EWS. And the target URI would be your EWS endpoint. You need to run test-OAuth connectivity from on-premise to Office 365 and Office 365 to on-premise. If the result shows as success, this means your OAuth has been set up correctly. Moving on. Here we have mentioned what are features of hybrid requires OAuth or which features make use of OAuth. I will take a quick pause here for you to go through the features which requires OAuth. So as you can see here, eDiscovery search that uses our eDiscovery search, which we make with CrossForest, requires OAuth. FreeBSY lookup also requires OAuth. Message records management also requires OAuth. In-place archiving is also requires OAuth. However, mailbox move do not require OAuth. So mailbox move still works with MRS proxy. It do not make use of OAuth. Moving on. In this example, we have considered an environment with OAuth. When an on-premise user makes a FreeBSY request for Joe, which is a user in online, the on-premise Exchange server determines that target user is external and does a lookup for an intra-organization connector to get the auto-discover endpoint for the external contoso.onmicrosoft.com. The on-premise Exchange server makes an anonymous request to that auto-discover endpoint and the server responds with a 401 challenge containing the ID for the trusted issuer from which it will accept tokens. The on-premise Exchange server requests an application token from Azure Auth service. This token is for Exchange on-premise and can be cached. If another user on-premise does a FreeBSY request for the same external organization, there is no round trip to AAD. The cached token can be used. The on-premise server then submits that new token to the EWS endpoint requesting for FreeBSY. Exchange Online authenticates the access token by lookup of application identity and validates the server-to-server security token. Exchange Online verifies that Ben is allowed to see Joe's FreeBSY and FreeBSY info is returned to the client. If you notice, here we have not made use of Microsoft Federation Gateway. So this is a major difference when FreeBSD is set up using OAuth. There is no involvement of Microsoft Federation Gateway. We rely on Azure Auth service. Moving on. These are a few tools which we use for common troubleshooting, like Test Exchange Connectivity, SARA, that is Support Assistance and Recovery, and PowerShell. To start with, this is Remote Connectivity Analyzer tool. We can make use of this tool to validate the AutoDiscover connectivity. You can also run FreeBSD test where you can see if FreeBSD is failing, where exactly it fails. You can also make use of Remote Connectivity Analyzer tool to analyze the header of the message. Moving on. Next tool that we normally use is SARA, Support Assistance and Recovery tool. We can make use of this tool to capture advanced diagnostic log or Outlook logs. This normally is used when post-migration users are not able to connect to the mailbox. So we can run SARA tool to understand or collect the advanced diagnostic log to understand where the profile is failing. Moving on. These are a few common issues that we would face and we will be discussing it today. So HCW fails, where exactly HCW fails or hybrid configuration wizard fails. The second issue that we would be discussing today is endpoint creation, mailbox move issues, few connectivity issues, mail flow issues, and FreeBSD issues. To start with, let's see the HCW fails. So these are the points, or you can say steps, on which a hybrid configuration wizard normally fails. When you run into an issue where hybrid configuration wizard fails, we first need to identify on which step it is failing. These are the points or steps on which hybrid configuration wizard most likely fails. And the majority of failure error that you will see would be on Federation Trust, all while creating the organization relationship. The best place to find what has caused the failure is to check the hybrid logs, which is available under Exchange Hybrid Configuration folder located in C drive. There you need to verify what is the last error which has been generated. Based on the error message, we follow our troubleshooting. So here, these are the points where we have to test or we have to check whether it is failing on any of these points. I'll just take a quick pause here for you to take a note of these points. Okay, moving on. The second most common issue that we encounter is endpoint creation. With the latest hybrid configuration wizard, it automatically creates the endpoint. However, you would sometime notice that hybrid wizard completed with a warning stating that endpoint creation failed. In this situation, we can validate if MRS proxy is enabled on CAS server. This can be validated using the command get-webservices-virtual-directory-pipe-fl. We also need to validate authentication methods that are allowed and make sure basic NTLM, Windows Integrated, WS Security, and OAuth are in allowed list. This can also be validated using the same command, get-webservices-virtual-directory. As an isolation, you can also try to browse the external URL and see whether you are getting the expected response. You can also run test-mrs-health to validate if Exchange Mailbox Replication Service is running. You can also run test-migration server availability to see if there are any sort of error which is getting generated. If you still see issues, you can collect IIS logs located at the folder inetpub logs log file, and you can check for EWS MRS proxy.svc file. If the issue is still persist, you can also collect HTTP proxy EWS log, and you can open a support ticket with us. Moving on, if you find issues while migrating mailboxes, depending upon the type of migration used, you can collect PowerShell output using these commands. For example, get-migration-batch-identity of that batch with a pipefl switch. You can also make use of the switch like diagnostic and include report. This will give you a granular details as to where the batch or the migration is failing. Depending upon the error collected in these PowerShell output, we can proceed further with the troubleshooting. We also need to ensure firewall doesn't pre-authenticate listed incoming requests. So these are the endpoints. If these endpoints are pre-authenticated on your TMG or firewall, that would cause an issues with mailbox move. So it is always advisable to bypass this or create exception on the firewall for these endpoints. As a best step, you can also try to stop the migration and resume to see if that helps. In this slide, this is a new feature which is integrated with migration, which provides you with possible grades. So what used to happen is when you try to migrate a mailbox, there are certain inconsistency which used to be noticed once the migration is complete. For example, if you are migrating a mailbox which is of 50 GB data in on-premise, post-migration, you might see that it does not have the same amount of data when the migration is complete. To avoid this inconsistency, this feature is introduced, which provides the grade based on the migration. So these are the four grades which is available: perfect, good, investigate, poor. So this is an automatic procedure which gets stamped to your move request whenever you initiate a move. And based on the grade, whether you can decide whether you want to continue with the migration or you have to look for the migration. Moving on. For Outlook connectivity issues, post-migration, these are some of the common checks that you can perform. We can make use of EXRCA tool to validate auto-discover connectivity. We can also validate using NSLOOKUP on the affected machine if it is resolving to the correct auto-discover record. Check for test email auto-configuration logs generated from Outlook to verify how Outlook is trying to connect to mailbox. You can also try to create registry to skip the last known good URL. You also have to validate if the mail enabled object is created with the correct target address stamped. And the last one, checking the Outlook version and patches. This is very important with once the mailbox is migrated, because Office 365 make sure that your Office 365 works with the latest Outlook build. So make sure your Outlook version are updated. Moving on. In this slide, we would be discussing about some mail flow issues where an on-premise user is not able to send email to Office 365 user. So the first thing that needs to be verified in this scenario is whether proper MEU is present with the target address. So you need to make sure a mail enabled object is present in your on-premise environment with a correct target address. Verify that the target accepted domain is set to internal relay. We also have to make sure that the public IP address of Exchange server is not blacklisted in Office 365. Verify the proper inbound connector has been created in Office 365. So when you run hybrid configuration wizard, an inbound connector automatically gets created. So we can make use of PowerShell commands to understand whether the configuration of inbound connector is set up correctly or not. If TLS is enabled, we can try to enable the opportunistic TLS. Please note, this is a workaround. If you want, you can try disabling TLS and see whether after disabling TLS, Mailflow is working or not. Moving on, you can also make use of Telnet and submit the mail from Exchange on-premise server to Office 365 using the MX record on port 25. This is the script or switches that you can use to perform a Telnet. If the Telnet mails are delivering fine, then try to enable the verbose logging from the send connector of your on-premise. Check the target host whether they are able to communicate with Office 365 server or not. If it is not, then you can also disable the send connector, which will allow you to send emails via the default connector. This is again a workaround. It is not a solution. So you can disable the send connector, which is being created by hybrid configuration wizard. By disabling the send connector, which is created by hybrid configuration wizard, it will start utilizing the default connector, which is there in your on-premise environment, and it will start routing the emails via internet. Moving on. Now we will discuss the issue where Office 365 user is not able to send an email to an on-premise user. Again, we have to verify whether a proper mail enable object is present with correct target address. Verify the target accepted domain is set to internal relay or not. Check the on-premise mailbox can receive emails from the external domain. Check the public IP address of the outbound connector, target host, and confirm whether port 25 is open for EOP IPs from the firewall. So we have an article which lists down all the EOP IPs. So you need to make sure port 25 is open for those EOP IPs on your firewall. Again, we have to verify all the inbound connector settings are created correctly or not. As a workaround, again, we can try disabling TLS or switch TLS to opportunistic TLS and see whether that resolves the mail flow issue. And later on, we can work on fixing the TLS issue. To disable TLS, you can use this command set-receive connector. Even if this does not resolve the issue, you can enable verbose logging and check for any error details. If you're still not able to find any error, then enable protocol login and verify if there is any hit from Office 365. You can also verify the firewall log on port 25 to validate if there is any connection which is coming from the EOP IPs. Moving on. In this slide, I have listed down some of the PowerShell commands that can be used when you are troubleshooting FreeBSD issues. So when a user complains about FreeBSD issue, the first thing to validate is if FreeBSD is using OAuth or DAuth. You can check this using the command get-intra-org connector and check whether this intra-org connector is enabled or not. This intra-org connector needs to be enabled both in on-premise as well as Office 365. If it is using DAuth, we then need to make sure org relationship and federation trust has proper configuration. So at the top, there are few commands like test-organization relationship, test-federation trust, the sharing policy that it is using, the web services virtual directory, whether the configuration, the authentication mechanism that is used, whether that has been set up correctly or not. As a when you run get-organization relationship, you can also verify whether target sharing EPR has been set up correctly or not. If nothing helps, you can look in IIS logs to understand why it is failing. If FreeBSD is set up using OAuth, you can run test-OAuth connectivity using the service EWS and defining the endpoint, the EWS endpoint. You need to run this test-OAuth connectivity both from on-premise as well as Office 365. So these are some common PowerShell command that can be used to isolate whether FreeBSD is using OAuth or DAuth and the preliminary information about the configuration. This brings to the end of our presentation. I hope this session was useful. Thank you very much for watching this session.